2003, the year Perry Farrell returned to the big day out, but this time with the newly reformed Jane's Addiction. It was the year of rock, with the Foo Fighters, Queens of the Stone Age, and the Deftones all joining the tour. It was the year Craig Nichols from the Vines got violent with a photographer during an interview.
I can't remember that.
One half of At the Drive-In returned, this time as Sparta.
I mean, we get emotional about it because it's for real.
And Underworld headlined the Boiler Room. It was the year German electronic pioneers Kraftwerk made their big day out debut. And the year PJ Harvey ate Jabba's Vegemite sandwich.
Does that work for you?
Oh, it's fantastic.
One more time. One more beat. Gates open. Step two.
You're watching the big day out live on Channel V.
If you are easily offended, turn off your television set right now.
Now, you're looking good, Perry. Put on a bit more makeup.
Who at the Big Day Out deserves a gold medal for rock?
Queens of the Stone Age.
I can't get enough of them. They're just too good.
Queens of the Kings.
After the success of their 2001 tour with the Big Day Out, Queens of the Stone Age returned to the tour in 2003, this time with a new album, Songs for the Deaf. The Rockers provided the hit of the summer with their single No One Knows, which also graced the top of the Triple J Hottest 100.
Well, I think the Queens of the Stone Age, that was that tour when, you know, it was a track and they were number one on the Hottest 100. They just owned the Big Day Out, you know, and that the song was just, it was the sound of summer. It was the sound of the Big Day Out. And they did that. They were playing nude. The bass player was playing nude. Yeah.
He must have a very big penis.
Well, I think you're absolutely right there.
And their drummer was just a monster because they'd done that album with Dave Grohl playing drums, and you thought you wouldn't want to be the drummer coming in after Dave played drums on an album. And he was a beast of a man. He was just an animal. And he was to watch him was just amazing. And it's funny because I saw the footage. I shot a lot of stuff on my own camera. From that tour, and I think half of it was pretty much him playing drums. It was weird. I just kept on seeing him, and I was so transfixed by his playing.
Andy, have you met your idols at all?
Well, meeting Joey the other night from the Queens.
You did meet Joey.
Yeah, I had a quick chat to him in the bar.
Do you talk kind of drum specs? Oh, I love that Remo 18-inch snare you're using there.
Not really, but he was such a nice guy.
He was a nice guy.
Yeah, sweet as pie.
So it's about 11 o'clock. About 10 past 11 here in Auckland, and after what happened during the Queens of the Stone Age set when the PA blew up 8 times, they've rebuilt the stage after the Datsuns were supposed to close the stage over here.
Queens of the Stone Age are playing, they're on the main stage in the middle of the day, they blow up the amp, they blow up the PA in Auckland.
They got really angry and they threw their guitars and walked off. I found out later that Ken West, who runs the Big Day Out, actually just put like thousands of dollars of cash in their hands. Just like, boom, that's for you, that's for you, that's for you, that's for you. 11 o'clock, I want you to go and play on the backstage.
So they're rescheduled to do a show on the little stage after the Datsuns have played over in the corner. About 5,000 people pack in because I had the right magic pass. Got to side of stage and it was like the Queens of the Stones were playing in my living room.
They were upset about the PA. They were kicking things. They were surly. They were boozy. They were angry. And they were just so great.
That has not got any better for that for me.
Queens of the Stone Age, of course, were at their prime. Since Nick Oliveri left, forget about the Queens and their new lineup. The Queens of the Stone Age will always be Josh and Nick to me, with, you know, guest appearances by Mark Lanegan.
If you were going to play a bit of tennis, which member of the Big Day Out would you want to partner with you in doubles?
Josh, because he's enormous.
I definitely would pick PJ. All She's got the style, and people will be focused on her, and I'll be serving on that ass.
After connecting on the 2001 Big Day Out tour, Queen's frontman Josh Homme and rock goddess PJ Harvey channeled their mutual respect into a much-anticipated collaboration.
Josh Homme from Queens of the Stone Age, we talked to him a couple of days ago and he said that, the one act that he has to check out each day of the Big Day Out is your show. There's been talk about you recording with him in the desert sessions. Is that just talk?
I'm definitely doing the desert sessions. We go down to do that in February right after this.
Wicked.
So I should be there and yeah, we like each other's music. I love his voice, so you never know what's going to happen.
Yeah, I've met her a few times, so I sort of half know her enough to say hello to. And she'd let her hair grow out, and she's naturally curly-haired. And like all curly-haired people, she wants her hair to be straight, and straight people want their hair curly. And as I'm doing the photo, she's saying to me, well, what do you think of curly hair? And I'm basically saying, hey, you're PJ Harvey, you look fantastic, curly or straight hair. And as I'm saying it, there's this ambulance coming right behind the photo session, and he's like just perving because he's got lights and looking. He's perving, goes straight into a police car and takes the police car out. To which I turn to PJ Harvey and say, that's how good you look.
Oh, I don't think you can go past PJ Harvey at the moment.
No one rocks better than Miss Polly Jean Harvey.
Her outfit for the big day out is sensational.
Can you describe it to folks who may not have seen it?
Short black shorts, black car, knee-high boots, quite a little, smallish black top, and she has a perm. It's wonderful.
And I'm right on time, and the birds keep singing.
We have a very special present for you.
Oh, is that for me?
Today. This is for you. It's designed in Australia but made in China.
I love it.
Oh, absolutely brilliant. And you can use that to hang up your one of two outfits.
Representing the Aussies on the 2003 tour were Friends Will Rom, 1200 Techniques, Jebediah, Rocket Science, Shehad, Machine Gun Fellatio and UMI. But the Australian band everyone was scrambling to see was the Vines, who were known for their chaotic and unpredictable frontman, Craig Nichols. The band had exploded overseas with their debut album, Highly Evolved, reaching number 11 on the US Billboard charts.
I did get to see a bit of the Vines when they played, and hasn't history changed the experience of the Vines? Like, apparently they played terribly at the Gold Coast, and there were rumours buzzing around that they were really embarrassed about the show that they did, which is the one that we've got on tape. But the Sydney, Melbourne and Adelaide, etc. ones were heaps better, and I got to see quite a few of those and was kind of like, okay, that's actually a band that can play and that has an interesting thing going on. Of course, they sort of exploded or imploded, and I think that's kind of a moment in time too, the Vines. Like, we see them come, we see them go, and I guess that's another beautiful thing about the big day out. You see bands that are basically one-hit wonders, but for a moment, they're the biggest f***ing thing in the world.
And are you late?
Yo, man, I got caught in traffic, man.
Caught in traffic? What happened to the chopper?
Oh, man, hey, you should have brought it out, man. I would have been there.
Perry Farrell had it booked.
Back writing and recording together after more than a decade since their last album, Jane's Addiction hit the road on the 2003 Big Day Out Tour in support of their third album, Strays.
2003, Ericsson Stadium in Auckland, and Jane's Addiction played, and I was so excited because, you know, I missed them when they toured, and I hear this, señores y señores, Juanes Addiction, and then Dave Navarro, you know, he's like this tall, he's about as tall as Anthony Clear, he comes out with his nipple rings going, and then Perry Farrell's like, here we go, and I just couldn't believe it. It was just every Jane's Addiction song I'd ever wanted to hear all at once, and it was great. And then they had a hot Asian chick in a caged ball, kind of doing tricks and dances, hanging out of the ceiling. I mean, you know, guitars, strippers. What more do you need from your big day out?
Who would you have on the bill of your own festival, Dave?
Who would I have? Yeah. I would have Jane's Addiction, of course.
Yep.
I would probably have Audioslave, perhaps the Foo Fighters, Queens of Stone Age, maybe PJ Harvey.
Metallica, would they factor in there at all?
I don't think so. Did they factor in my answer?
You got to interview Jane's Addiction, and it's like Dave Navarro's got a manager. The drummer Stephen Perkins has got a manager. Perry Farrell's got a manager. It's like, you know, there's like all these management hanging around. You know, what questions are you going to ask? And I just ask rubbish questions. You do another Lola?
I sure would.
Who would you put on the bill? Would you have Avril Lavigne on the bill?
Would you?
Well, it's not my call.
I'd have her on the writer. You notice how I can deflect all these answers?
Yeah, that's brilliant. And it was over, and it was like, that was my Jane's Addiction interview. That was shit. And if you're a Jane's Addiction fan and you thought that was a shit ass interview, absolutely, absolutely. I think that's what you get when you have a band with five different managers and five different record labels. They wouldn't give us rights to film their set. It's G-ups all around.
And
so,
frankly, their wardrobe clashed terribly.
Oh, I don't know what's going on with Perry Farrell's bling things.
Kind of puts a downer on your whole day. Here they are, who cares? They're idiots. Well, they're not idiots, but they're gods. Who is the ringmaster of the big day out? Is there anyone?
David Grohl.
We've kind of been watching Dave Grohl walk around, and he seems to have the magic.
Everyone wants a piece of him. He can't get away from it.
So I get the feeling he's the most popular kid at school right now.
Slayer!
2003 also saw the return of crowd favourites, the Foo Fighters. While the band played their first Big Day Out tour in 2000, it had been 11 years since frontman Dave Grohl graced the stages of the inaugural Big Day Out in 1992 as the drummer for Nirvana.
The original 92 Big Day Out, no, due to a miscommunication issue, we videoed the Nirvana set, which is, it's got crap sound on it. No, it's just because we had a delay screen somewhere and we were meant to not record it. 10 years later, I burnt one off on DVD and it, edited up the sound slightly with it, cleaned it up a little bit, and gave it to Dave backstage in Adelaide. And I said, look, I know we've had Courtney through a couple of times and stuff, but I didn't think she was the right person to hand this to, and the tour manager said he got pretty teary about it because he watched it on his computer.
Hey, what's so different about this year's Big Day Out?
Well, we get to go on at night.
That's
kind of
nice. Part.
When it's not 130 degrees, that's kind of cool. We get some lights.
Yeah. Big lights, massive banners. The Spinal Tap banners.
The 2003 tour also introduced Australian audiences to the new acts bursting onto the scene, including Murder Dolls, the brainchild of Joey Jordison from Slipknot and Trip Bison from Static X, and UK indie rockers The Music.
The music were just incredible. I'd been hearing, everyone kept on talking about see the music, and I was standing side of stage in Perth watching them. And it was just, like Perry Farrell, PJ Harvey, like all the bands were just standing there. I think everyone had heard about them. And by that stage, everyone's going, we'll go and check it out. And we stood there and they came on, that Gorky guy dancing. He's just incredible. And the sea of the crowd, just swelling, going up and up and down. And I thought, this is a gig I'd like to play. I wish I could be this. Whatever he is, I want to be that.
Murder Dolls! Murder Dolls!
Murder Dolls, they rock the wardrobe.
This song is called I Love to Say F**k. Can you say F**k?
The Murder Dolls. Again, Auckland, Big Day Out. The umbrella of F**k. He comes out with this umbrella of Joey.
And then the very last song, which is also ironically not on our album.
One that you like with the umbrella.
Yeah, that's not on the album.
Yeah, I love to say fuck.
We all say fuck.
What's the... I can't think of the song. Some stupid song all about the word fuck. Top word. I can really give
a fuck. It's kind of like, have a good time at our show. Don't really think about anything outside of that. So we definitely don't encourage people to be gothic and doomy and hide in a corner and be depressed, it's just go out and have a good time and fuck everybody else.
Still to come on BDO XB 2003, Yumi gets toasted and the feuding fires up backstage.
One, two, three!
In 2003, Channel V covered the Big Day Out tour live from the Gold Coast, Sydney, Melbourne and Adelaide, bringing the viewers all the best interviews and live performances from over 30 different artists.
I do remember being terrified that Channel V were filming us, and I had a big argument, not an argument, but with your producers saying don't film us, because they did put us up against the Foo Fighters and Kraftwerk. Like, they didn't do it, the Channel V didn't do it, but we were at a time when there were like four major acts playing, and we were nervous that we weren't going to have a crowd. And luckily about 8,000 people turned out to watch us, but we were terrified. We had Toast Girl, who was this really crazy Japanese performance artist who we hit it off with. And she was so cute, and she'd have a toaster on her head, and she had these two girls who would follow her in nappies who were walking on sort of vacuum cleaners. You're a fine white girl. Anyway, we begged her to come on stage with her babies, and that was pretty cute. A lot of people were flirting with her.
Another time I was at the Adelaide Big Day Out and the lily pad guys go, all right, Yumi, come here and stand next to Toast Girl.
I cook toast on my head.
She walks around with a toaster on her head and cooks toast.
Toast Girl had two nappy dances.
So we'd actually taught these three Japanese girls who barely spoke English at all. We'd basically taught them how to sing Come On, Aussie, Come On.
Come on, Aussie, come on. Come on.
Hello and welcome to Live in Osaka.
Come on, Aussie, come on. Come on.
We're looking forward to an amazing Aussie section.
Come on, Aussie, come on. Come on.
We make sure that at the lily pad, we drop pills, not bombs.
The lily pad, I'm frightened by the lily pad.
The lily pad, oh, I really liked that naked guy there before. Yeah, he was quite, you know, well built. Nice hat and so on, and his singing wasn't that great, but yeah, it was okay.
Yeah, we've had lots of people come and play with us over the years. Last year we had Carl Cox played in a blonde wig in Perth. Incognito, we've had Africa Bambaataa play, Adam Freelance played, the Black Eyed Peas came down, the Dandy Warhols. After a few shows on each tour, we've got to meet the different characters and personalities, and they come down and play with us and usually have a great time.
And those guys are also in charge of putting on all the after parties. When you stay in the Big Day Out hotels, all the bands stay in the same hotel, and they put little faxes underneath your door. So have you been involved in many after party shenanigans?
No, not that many. Yes, we beat up the guy from Underworld.
Love you with all my ass.
There was a fight between you and Underworld?
No, we can't, sorry.
Oh, come on.
In typical Rockstar fashion, talk of feuds and rumours were rife backstage amongst the artists on the 2003 tour.
Another rumour I really liked was that the lead singer of Waikiki and Phil from Grinspoon got it on. I don't know if that's true. Because at first they were kind of bagging each other out, or she was bagging him out. She was bagging quite a few people out, actually. She was bagging Dave Grohl out as well.
You know, he walks around and everyone, snapping his fingers and people are following him.
This is all on tape. This is not me speculating or remembering in a wacky way. Wacky to Becky.
So we're wondering if you've heard any rumours about this tour, about band breakups or in-band fighting or inter-band fighting
actually,
at all.
I think we're breaking up.
We're breaking up a couple of times.
Is there any bands that you can't stand? You'd like to start some kind of rivalry with a band right here, right now?
No, we don't like rivalry.
You don't like rivalry?
Divines.
Divines, there we go.
Is it true about the pre-shrunk Vines punch-up that I've heard a lot about?
There is
one tight on that one. Get right in there.
A shiner. What the Christ is going on there?
The story was, went backstage, had a look at the Vines gear. Thought, looks pretty nice, I might smash it up.
I can't remember that, I don't know.
Duvage from Pre-Shrunk was sporting a black eye yesterday backstage.
Five stitches.
Who flogged you in the face with the bass?
Craig, actually.
Did he?
I don't think I would have done that, but...
Any of that sort of stuff happening on the Machine Gun Fellatio stage?
Just with each other.
What's been the best band that you've shot so far?
For action, a cross between Deftones or the Vines. Great action on stage.
Did the Vines destroy the equipment today?
Destroyed lots of things on stage and looked pretty cool.
Did they hit any of each other?
No, they never attacked each other. It was purely an equipment demolition job.
Now, I'm thinking that the boys from Kraftwerk would also be enjoying the Australian summer at the moment. Have you had much time to talk to them at all?
Unfortunately not. We have had a long-standing feud. German electronic musicians are very competitive.
I heard that Kraftwerk don't actually do anything. They just play on their, like, PCs, like, play games.
I think they're playing chess with each other, yeah. They're standing there with their laptops and they're going, all right, play the dance.
They're responding to their emails.
Is there a chance that you may reconcile on this tour?
Actually, the truth of the matter is we're Canadian. We live in Germany, and Kraftwerk are kind of untouchable legends. We're kind of the new kids on the block, so to speak. So there isn't much mixing. And, German electronic musicians are competitive, but let's just say musicians are competitive overall. So there isn't as much mixing as you think. There's a lot of feuds. The Foo Fighters are in a really heavy feud with the Deftones at the moment, involving PJ Harvey. And so there's not much mixing.
Yeah, we've heard a lot of rumors. Taylor, what can you add to the, can you throw fuel on the fire of controversy here at the Big Day Out?
Basically, the first time in Australia means fighting. I don't know what's with this place. I don't know what's with this festival, but Waikiki and Jebediah have been messing with each other all day. You know, those pranks, there's always
these silly pranks going on? Why does this have to happen? Competition exists for a reason, but why does this have to happen now?
Now, we've been hearing a lot about the rivalry between the Queensland and Victorian hip-hop crews, Rez and Dogs. They're out for blood with 1200 Techniques. What's going on there?
We've not heard anything.
You're full of shit, man.
Are you trying to stir it all up?
You staring bastard. How am I supposed to live in a world full of negatives?
How am I supposed to love in a world full of bullshit? Next on BDO XV 2003, Jabba finds himself in a ping pong match with the Deftones, and Chit Chat gets a sausage from Dave Grohl. The 2003 Big Day Out Tour culminated in Perth on the 2nd of February, having attracted over 218,000 punters across Australia and New Zealand.
I really think that the tour is almost as good as the playing, as the gigs. Like, this, I really like the socialising between all the different bands. Like, and rock and roll can be quite a competitive, you know, scene. You know, who's that? This much. She sucks. And by the end, ah, you're the greatest man in the world. I love you so much. You know, and that happens all the time. And just seeing how the little hierarchies work and everyone ends up becoming a real brotherhood. So by the end in Perth, everyone's just great friends, and that's including internationals. It just takes some time.
And the two best, I think, if you are touring, I mean, not to put a point up, but is definitely Gold Coast, because everyone, it's like first day of camp or whatever. Everyone turns up and goes, right, let's go nuts, drink everything and take everything and go crazy. Sydney is starting to go, right, there's five more of these, we better calm down. But then in Perth they go, I finished work for the day, we're going to tear this town apart, and they do. The night of Big Day Out in Perth is a very messy night.
Josh Hunt from Queens of the Stone Age, 5 a.m. in the hotel lobby playing No One Knows on the piano. For just whoever was there, it's like, wow, man, that's rock, isn't it? That's rock and roll. Like, you're still living it, you're still loving it, you're still playing it.
But the best thing about that tour for me was that Queens of the Stone Age did it, and those boys were always the last left, as were, it seemed to be a lot of times, members of my band at night, and they went very hard. And the Foos did it as well, Foo Fighters. So Josh from Queens of the Stone Age and Dave from Foo Fighters did a barbecue in Perth for all the other bands. And so Dave Grohl cooked me a sausage, which I think's nice. And he went up and he went, thanks, Dave. Bit crappy, but then it was all right. So that was a nice feel.
We used to have to encourage them intermingling too much, but this thing's gotten so big that we're in multiple hotels now as opposed to one, and different flights and all over the place, and they need to make the effort. And sometimes they're a bit shy, really, literally. I mean, they're fans too. Table tennis tables are good for that. Air hockey's very good for that because it's kind of violent as well.
When it first started, and for the first few years, it was very much like the international bands and the Australian bands. And what we've seen in the last few years is where Australian bands, like, you know, it could be Powderfinger, it could be us, or, you know, Grinspoon or Jet or whoever, can basically get the crowd happening, and as many people are coming to see those bands and get them rocking as the international bands. So there's a real equality that's developing backstage now, where we're getting more and more respect from the international acts. And as the years wear on, and I think that's helping to make it socialise even better, you know, backstage. And, you know, there's nothing like getting pissed with people day after day to form great friendships, what can I say?
We played with Wilco a bit, you know, who's not someone you would think would freak you out, but he had a great manner about him, and he was, he toured, I was quite into his album at the time, and I didn't think that much of him, but his players were extraordinary and really, really friendly to meet.
In Auckland, the Deftones had set up in the hotel lift. They'd set up a small table with a cocktail bar on it, and they were going upstairs and downstairs up to the 16th floor and serving cocktails to everyone.
And meeting them in the lift and them going, do you want to come up to our room? We just bought a ping pong table and a stereo, so...
They'd actually totally cleared all the furniture out of their room, 1620, and the only thing in there was this ping pong table.
Going up there with Andrew, buying like a whole case of beers, and going there and playing ping pong with the Deftones, and then started talking about politics and Iraq, and it got a bit nasty, and they looked very patriotic. So that's the point where we went, all right, we're going to go now.
And I remember going up there, I was going to bed and I was in a cow suit with sort of nipples on the front of it. And I thought, oh, there's a bit of action going on here, going to this party.
Who is the, you know, the best ping pong player in the Deftones?
It's undetermined.
It's undetermined. Yeah, Abe seemed to have the upper hand there in Auckland.
Sometimes that's good. You have good days, bad days, you know. Today might be a good day, I don't know.
And there was a ping pong competition at 20 past four in the morning. I beat the guy, Jim from Sparta, who'd been on the table all night in a cow suit. And that was a bit of a laugh. He was very upset.
Next time on BDO XV, we celebrate the 2004 Big Day Out with Jet, Black Eyed Peas, The Darkness and Metallica.
One more time. One more beat. Gates open. Step through.